The high seas is home to life from the tiniest microscopic plankton all the way up to oceanic giants like the blue whale or oceanic white-tipped sharks. These are creatures that thrive in the emptiness of the blue open space.
The high seas make up about two-thirds of the world's ocean. It is a vast expanse beyond national jurisdiction, but ignored at our own peril.
The high seas is a life support system for the planet. It occupies virtually half of the space in this world, and that means that what goes on there really matters to all of us.
The health of the high seas impacts the health of the entire network of ocean life and marine life as we know it.
Overfishing, climate change, mining, and other threats are wreaking havoc on the high seas, which lack centralized oversight from one governing body.
The high seas is currently managed by this patchwork of regional and international organizations that each have jurisdiction over certain types of activities. But this patchwork really doesn't provide adequate management because there's no coordination between these existing bodies and a lot of gaps exist.
In June 2015, the United Nations General Assembly took an important step to address these gaps by deciding to develop a new treaty for the high seas and convening a preparatory committee to start the process.
Resolution 69292, the enabling resolution, which kickstarted the preparatory committee, was adopted by consensus. So that in itself shows that there is a willingness on the part of the international community to move forward. So that's the starting point.
Governments will continue to meet to address the most pressing challenges to conserving high seas biodiversity, like an inability to establish marine reserves there.
Marine protected areas and marine reserves on the high seas will allow us to protect special places that are very vulnerable to human activities.
One of the things people have done to the environment over time is to degrade and deplete it. Marine protected areas will help reverse that trend, rebuilding life and enabling those ecosystems to be much more resilient to the sort of stresses and shocks that lie ahead.
While many leaders have created marine reserves in their national waters, protection is needed beyond those borders to meet these challenges.
The science says that we really need to be protecting something of the range of 30 to 40% of the oceans from exploitation and harm in order to safeguard life there. We can't possibly get to that number without protecting the high seas.
The UN is working toward that aim, and those close to the negotiation find reason for hope.
I was encouraged by what I witnessed as chair during the first session. There is a recognition that the time to act is now.
With this treaty, world leaders have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to do something significant for the planet.
If we choose to do the right things and protect the planet better, reduce our impact on it, countless generations will benefit from that in the future.
I cannot think of the next generation of Palauans or the children of my children without a healthy ocean. It's important that we do what must be done, not eventually, but right now.